Hi, I'm Phil Nichols from the Department of Agriculture and Food, Western Australia, and I'm going to talk a bit about best bet legumes and grasses for medium to high rainfall saltland pastures. So this is likely to interest farmers in the medium to high rainfall areas of southern Australia who want to make their saltland more productive or even to just rehabilitate degraded land. Now, the information I'm presenting is focused on Western Australia, but it is applicable to similar environments in South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales and Tasmania. So here we're talking about an annual rainfall typically greater than 400 millimetres and where the main growing season is autumn through to spring. So what are some of the features of saline environments? Well, the most obvious thing is they reduce the growth and survival of crop and pasture plants. And these environments are often associated with winter waterlogging due to the rising of the water tables close to the surface. And this waterlogging makes the effect of salinity even greater. And so waterlogged saline soils are very hostile for plant growth. One of the other features is that saltland is spatially very variable, and we've measured tenfold differences in salinity levels within just a metre. And another thing is that the surface salinity levels change throughout the year, particularly on sandy and sandy loam soils, although they're less variable below about 25 centimetres depth. And I'll just illustrate this here. This is for a sandy loam soil at Darkin in Western Australia. And we've plotted here, on this axis here, the salinity levels in the top 10 centimetres measured as electrical conductivity units. And you'll see that in the summer and early autumn, the levels in the top 10 centimetres are at their maximum. And then we get the break of season, and the rains flush the salts from the surface down to lower in the profile. So during the winter, we're talking about lower salinity levels. And in fact, for some species with at least moderate salt tolerance, they're quite able to grow satisfactory under these conditions. And then as the soils dry out in spring and summer, the levels of salinity increase again. Okay, I'll talk firstly about pasture legumes. And our interest in them is because they increase animal production. They're high quality feed in their own right. They're very nutritious and high protein levels and high digestibility. They're also able to fix atmospheric nitrogen, and this enables other species in the pasture to also grow better. But most legumes are susceptible to salinity, and it means that saline areas tend to be nitrogen deficient. But economic studies have shown that if you can establish legumes into saltland pastures, it can have a marked effect on increasing profitability. Now, subterranean clover is the most widely sown annual legume throughout southern Australia, but it's particularly sensitive to salinity, and it's one of the first plants to disappear once soils become saline. So I'll talk firstly about annual legumes that are suited to saline areas. Firstly, for those that are well drained. Now, the biomedics have performed particularly well in many situations, and glasshouse studies have shown that they are moderately salt tolerant, but they only perform well where waterlogging is not a big issue. They'll tolerate transient waterlogging, but not prolonged situations of waterlogging. They prefer sandy loams to clay loams of moderate acidity to neutral pH. And of the cultivars for the medium rainfall areas, Cavalier is the latest flowering, and Scimitar and San Diego are other options, with Scimitar and Cavalier having performed the best of those. Now, the barrel medics have also got moderate salt tolerance, but not quite as good as the burr medics. They also don't tolerate waterlogging. They prefer heavier soils of higher pH than the Burmedics. And of the aphid-resistant cultivars, Jester is the best one suited to medium rainfall areas. Now, a recent addition to the suite of options is Jota Bacara clover, Melanotus albus, sometimes known as white sweet clover. Now, this was released due to its good performance in Western Victoria. So we talk about quite high rainfall areas here, and particularly on raised beds. Now, it's got some interesting advantages for annual production. It's moderately salt tolerant, similar to the Burmedics, but it's very high, very productive and remains green well into summer. But it does have some significant disadvantages, and one is it contains a chemical compound called coumarin that can taint meat, milk and grain samples if it gets in there. And the other thing is this coumarin, if you make hay from Jota and other Melanotus albus, and it gets wet and the hay turns mouldy, this coumarin turns into another compound called dicoumarol, and it can cause hemorrhaging of livestock. And the other thing is that although it's got salt tolerance, it hasn't got waterlogging tolerance. So I talked about annual legumes for poorly drained soils, and Balanza and Persian clovers are really the key species here. They've got good waterlogging tolerance, but we've done glasshouse studies that show that really they haven't got very good salt tolerance. They are better than the subclovers, but they're nowhere near as good as the Burmedics, for example. They can perform quite often quite well in the first year, but their persistence is often poor. So really they're best suited to waterlogged soils with little to low salinity levels. Now of the Balanza clover cultivars, well there are three of them. Frontier for medium rainfall areas, Paradana for medium to high rainfall areas, and Boulder for high and very high rainfall areas. And there are some more recent other cultivars raised by other seed companies. Now, as far as Persian clover goes, there are two types. Firstly, the grazing or resupinatum types. Sardi Persian, Prolific and Nitro Plus are suited to medium rainfall areas, and Kyambro for high rainfall areas. There are also fodder types, erect growing, magus types, which are really suited to making very good quality hay or silage. And these are really only suited to the very high rainfall areas. Now, Marl is the original cultivar, but there are some more recent ones, including Laser, Lesion, Moorbulk, Lightning, and some other ones been released by some of the seed companies. In terms of perennial legumes, strawberry clover is one that has got good waterlogging tolerance, but its level of salinity tolerance is also reasonably low. So really it's best suited to waterlogged soils with fresh water or low levels of salinity. Palestine is the original cultivar used in Australia, but there are some other ones, O'Connor's and two New Zealand ones, Grasslands Onward and Grasslands Upward. Now Lucerne's another perennial species, which is sometimes associated with saline areas. It does have moderate salinity tolerance, but its waterlogging tolerance is quite low, and it's really only suited to well-drained soils. But it is very deep-rooted and does have an important role to play for helping to lower water tables if it's planted upslope of the discharge areas and in surrounding areas. And there's a whole range of Lucerne cultivars available, and we found that they don't really differ a great deal in their salinity tolerance. In terms of the temperate perennial grasses, well, Puccinella really is the king of saltland environments. It is the most salt and waterlogging tolerant of the commercially available pasture grasses. In fact, it really relies on waterlogging to perform at its best. It's quite slow growing in the first year, but can be quite productive in following years. And when it's green, its feed quality is quite good, but it does go dormant over summer, and the quality of its dry feed is really only maintenance levels. Tall wheatgrass is another commonly used species in saline areas. It's got quite good salinity tolerance, but it doesn't have the waterlogging tolerance that Puccinellia has. But it is a very productive grass, responds to summer rain, but it does form tussocks and can become quite clumpy if it's not managed well. And in Victoria in particular, it's been rated as a very high environmental weed risk. Tyrrell's the oldest cultivar, whereas Dundas is a more recent release. Now, two other grasses that are sometimes used in mildly saline environments are Phalaris here and Tall Fescue on the right-hand side here. They're really only suited to high rainfall areas, at least 500 millimetres. There are several cultivars of each species available, but they're really only a marginal plant for saline areas. Now, in terms of the temperate annual grasses, first one here is annual ryegrass, good old annual ryegrass. It does have moderate salt tolerance, and in fact often comes into mildly and moderately saline pastures from surrounding pastures. Wimmera is the original cultivar, and a more recent variety is Safeguard, which has got resistance to annual ryegrass toxicity. Another annual species that can be used sometimes in mildly saline situations is Italian ryegrass. It's a long season annuals, suited to high rainfall areas. You get diploid and tetraploid types, and there's a range of different cultivars that are available. Now, I'll just talk a little bit about three different subtropical perennial grass options. And the first one of these is Kikuyu, which does have a moderate level of salt tolerance and some waterlogging tolerance. Now, it spreads by both above ground stolons and below ground rhizomes. It forms a dense turf under grazing, and it needs regular grazing to stop it becoming thatchy. And Wittet is the commercially available cultivar of it. Rhodes grass is another subtropical grass. Being a subtropical, its main growth period is in the warmer months over summer. It goes dormant in winter, and it's frost sensitive. So really, it's limited to frost-free areas. So in Western Australia, we're talking about the northern agricultural region and along the south coast coastal strip. It's really only suited to well-drained soils with mild salinity. And lastly, I'll talk a bit about Desticulus. It's highly salt and waterlogging tolerant. Nipa forage is the cultivar that's available, but it's only sown by runners. There are no seed can't be produced off it, and so it's quite an expensive option, and it's also slow to spread. So really, it's probably not a feasible option for broad scale situations, and its main role is really for amenity and environmental improvements on small sites. So I mentioned early that saltland is spatially quite variable. So the best way to counter this is to sow mixtures of some of the best bet species and cultivars. And the idea is that the species will colonise those areas to which they're best adapted. And just to illustrate this here, we've got a site at Lake Grace in Western Australia. And you'll see here that it's a gradient of salinity and waterlogging. Down the bottom here, where it's quite waterlogged, we've got Balancer clover and Puccinellia here. Further up the slope, where it's still saline but not waterlogged, is where the Burmedics and tall wheatgrass perform well. And further up the slope, it's actually non-saline, as you can see by Cape Weed, and that's where subclover will grow, and it's also croppable. So it just illustrates how different species find different niches in the landscape. So if you'd like further information, DAFRA has just published a new farm note, which can be downloaded from the DAFRA website. And there's also quite a lot of good information on the Saltland Genie website, which I've shown here. So I'd like to thank you for listening and wish you good luck in improving your saltland pastures.